Namaste. Welcome to the Bhavan London Summer School 2019. We are delighted to have 8 senior most dancers and musicians with us who will be training the students for 3 weeks and also performing for the audience. This year we have something more special. I'm Anvi and I'll be hosting a roundtable discussion with them, and you will be getting to hear their opinions, their perceptions and their ideas on a wide range of topics related to Indian classical arts. I'll briefly introduce the artists of today's roundtable to you. Sri Nagaraj Rao Havaldar, Sri Arup Chattopadhyay, Sri Gaurav Mazumdar, Sri Lalgudi Krishnan, Srimati Saswati Sen, Srimati Devie Neithiyar, and Sri Surya Rao.
Namaste.
Thank you all so much for being a part of this. I'm sure it's going to be a wealth of ideas and a wealth of perception. And starting off with the first thought that I have in mind, you've all been involved with the arts for a very long time. I can say almost for your whole life. And as they say, you know, art and life are almost inseparable. So what do you think feeds art from life? And what does art feed back into life?
One by one?
However.
For all of us, art is our life.
Mm.
And of course, life has taught us so much, including the direct experience of art, vis-a-vis the audience, the people around our accompanying artists. Every minute we learn, not only from the art, how to be a good person, how to harmoniously behave in society, because every one of us individually is incomplete. We need our friends, our companions to complete me. So unless we have a good faith and respect, mutual respect, which is, and the humility and the modesty which the art teaches, is the biggest training in life that I've got.
It's fantastic. Yeah, I think there's a lot of values, especially with Indian classical training, because it is so intense. I think it automatically brings in a lot of value to a student's life, which they, I think, carry on for life.
I think most important aspect, what you asked, what feeds art. I think in all our case, because I personally know all of you very well, and also in my case, is that single aspect of sadhana, which feeds our art, because we have gone through that system of Guru Shishya Parampara, where we have chosen a guru and then we have served our guru, stayed with our guru and taken their love and blessings, their teachings, and that is not to make music a career, but to just take it as a way of life and make music something which is inseparable in our everyday life. And that sadhana is what makes people different, people who have practiced it, because there's a certain element of sacrifice, there's a certain element of that fanatic zeal to practice, to do riyaz, there's a fanatic zeal to imbibe what the guru embodies, and it's that element of sadhana which makes all the difference and feeds our art.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, I think art teaches us the art of living, so to say, the nuances of life, as all of them put it, and they just don't speak, they all live what they speak, the humility. It's not like they just some words, and you know, all the great legends of whom we all are part of, they all lived what they taught. Most of them did not speak, they didn't talk big words, they didn't talk about personality goals or whatever it is, but they just led a life, which I think we imbibed, or we got, probably consciously, of course, because they wanted subconsciously and unconsciously sometimes. So it just goes into our thing, and that's a dakshina that we can give them, you know, in the truest sense of it. To live up to all the nuances that they lived. And I think this is what art gives to any seeker of art.
Art, I feel, makes one very reasonable, humane, and it elevates. It is, after all, an expression of the experience that the artist undergoes. And it is, I would easily compare it to a green car. You can draw energy and grow, and you need not be just a container of the art.
Yeah.
You can be influenced by the art, and you can grow, and the art can grow.
It's fantastic. It's almost like it's part of your system.
Absolutely.
And then it continues, kind of a thing.
Yeah. Art is basically it's a refined expression of your life's experience.
Mm.
Everything that you experience in life has been reflected in music or dance. For example, as a vocalist, I would see that what is the relation between the raga and the artist?
Mm.
Is it just a scale?
Mm.
Is it just about vadi and samvadi, or just tayari, or speed, or gamak, or neen? It's a little more beyond that. When you start learning a raga, it will be like your parent. It will tolerate all the small mistakes you make. If you learn higher out, agar aap whistle gaye to komal shabd honge. Okay, it will tolerate you. And if you persist the same raga for another maybe 10 years, it will become your school friend. You have much more rapport with the raga. You try to interact with the raga with much more liberty and thought process. And if you further pursue the same raga for another 15, 20 years, it will become your life partner. The things that you share with your parents is different. The things that you share with your schoolmate is different. The thing that you share with your life partner is different.
It's totally different.
If
yeah.
you still further pursue the same raga for another 20, 30 years, you have a remote or maybe a strong chance of becoming the parent of the raga, where the raga tends to obey. You can take it around. But it needs amazing sadhana, as Gaurav Bhai said, persistence, practice, riyas,
humility.
Think of your guru,
humility.
Above
all,
humility.
Probably
you
will never think that you have become the parent, but you will still. So
well, the raga treats you like a parent.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you must allow that to happen organically, not that
it's
you really.
Cycle.
It just happens. And
yeah.
a time comes when the raga says, okay, what do you want to do with me today?
Hmm.
And that's a beautiful feeling.
You kind of converse with it.
Yeah.
All the time. You see the raga, you see the lay, you see the tal, you see the swaras, you see it rather than hearing it. So it's a beautiful feeling.
And it never
so
ends.
Well put. So
it's
well
an
never,
endless,
never ends,
And it's endless because you
endless.
Keep learning. It's
keep
you
learning,
keep discovering. There's not a day that we think, okay, I think we have discovered everything
attained.
In a certain
way.
And
there's no end to it. No full stop.
Notwithstanding each of those relations, you keep coming back to those relations.
Yes.
Yeah.
Once you get married, you don't forget your parents, unless it's a different society altogether.
Right.
Or you never forget your school friends. So therefore, you would like to refresh your relation with the same raga at a different level. So it's an ongoing process.
Yeah.
So.
Come, Surya.
Exactly. It's like art is everyday breathing and living for us.
Hmm.
In a personal point of view, if I take, it's a river which is already flowing, which has no end, which has no beginning.
Mm.
We are just part of it. We are going in the river or just a stream. We are joining into the river. And this should flow through us to the next generation so that basically what I have seen, artists lead a happy life in the society without any, like I have not seen an artist becoming a terrorist.
Yeah.
We can take life into
other way around
other
might
way
be
around.
Possible.
maybe you
definitely.
Never know.
Yeah, that's the power of
Valmiki.
I've so many times told.
Valmiki.
Yes.
He wrote Ramayana.
So
and
I feel that we can pass on something very positive to the next generation through art.
When you're saying about art, there's so much more to say.
Yes.
For a dancer, it builds our own
personality.
Mm.
Exactly.
The whole posture, the whole how I look, how I smile, how dance teaches us all this. They say when an artist goes across a crowd of people, people look around and say, artist hoga.
It's just a way
there's
of
an
life.
Aura.
Yeah.
There's an aura with the artist carries
so
because
true.
Of
so
the
true.
Beauty of its
art
inside.
Oh, yeah.
The manifestation,
absolutely.
Basically.
Yeah.
And however good a parent you become for a raga, sometimes on stage it behaves like a stranger at times.
Yeah.
Because that receiver, the antenna has to be all the time very powerful and finely tuned. Because
correct.
The same child will behave like a stranger. That's the beauty of the art.
Yeah. And I think in the case of dancers, it's like our body becomes the raga.
Yes.
And on stage, you sometimes feel like, what am I doing? Kind of a thing. You feel like
people
a stranger.
People say yoga, this, that. Our dance itself gives
it's,
us everything.
Yeah.
Everything. It's yogic.
And it gives peace of mind.
Correct.
Everything.
Correct. Most important, it really gives a certain
artists
amount of...
Artists are always in joyful mood, always joking,
yeah.
good and bad jokes.
Yeah. You can get a
but they're always happy.
Yeah. At the end of the day, all are happy.
All are happy.
Yes. Yeah. I think also, along with the happiness part, I think all artists, most of them, they lead a very intense life because they connect with life so much. And coming to the point of humility that I think all of you raised with Indian classical arts especially, the system of following the Guru Shishya Parampara. In today's world, I don't want to comment on how it is in today's world. I'd like to hear from you what you feel has changed, what has evolved. And I mean, even a lot of people are doing these online classes, so technology is being used in arts. So what does that mean for Indian classical arts? Because it's already so structured and it has its own identity.
You have asked two questions in one. Let's go into one thing. Hmm. First, the generation now. The generation is very self-motivated, self-vested. We learned the art for the art's sake, not to become something or not to gain something, neither money or no. I come from a totally non-musical family, doctors. I was also studying medicine. But this art drew me. But my parents never thought I would earn a farthing from this. It was not towards any gains, but it was the peace of soul, and that was a time when we were learning. Now, every bachcha, every parent, as soon as they think of taking up art, they think of something which is material gain or maybe money or fame or name or so and so and so. That's why the depth of art is being lost, the perseverance and the patience that is required for a mango tree to grow and bear fruits, you have to wait that time. But nowadays, children are too restless. They are achieving perhaps faster than we did, but they're also losing a lot of what they can carry. It's like, even like everywhere, even in films, they are here for program and then they're nowhere because half-baked, half-made.
It's distilled.
I totally agree with Didi in this. And also I need to accept this fact, but younger generation are well knowledged nowadays because of Google and also the
YouTube
and all the...
When you're talking about technology, of course it's good.
Exactly.
But
good.
Just
see,
as a support.
I have a different feeling to the whole thing. I feel whatever you learn from your guru is knowledge. Whatever you get from Google or...
Information.
It's information, yeah? So how do you translate information to knowledge? Only a guru can do. But I have always believed that the Guru Shishya Parampara was never, even maybe 1,000 years back, not everybody was following it.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a handful of people who were able to sacrifice, leave their families, leave their studies, profession, go to a guru, live with the guru for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, maybe all their life. So is the case today. There are a lot of genuine, wonderful students. I follow Guru Shishya Parampara. I have got wonderful disciples who learn from me at home. At the same time, I have disciples who learn on Skype. And now it's my duty as a guru to give them the same knowledge, what is possible on Skype. I shouldn't blame technology is helping me in connecting with a disciple who is maybe thousands of kilometers away. Due to whatever reason, finances, family, they are not able to do what I did. That does not mean they should not experience this the beauty of this art. Okay. It's a guru's duty to give the lesson appropriately to a disciple, even though he's on Skype for an hour, once a week, twice a week, maybe once a month, doesn't matter. The guru has to be equipped to give the... So we cannot blame the students. The students are very talented today.
Yeah.
They are fast learners, much more than what we were. It's the guru's duty because it's not... We are not teaching disciples because of anything, but we have to keep the art alive.
Right.
We'll be gone in another 20, 30 years. Yeah, we are in our 50s already. What happens after that? only when we are progressive. Mm-hmm. We cannot say, no, I will only teach as a Guru Shishya Panapari, you leave everything and come. It's not practical.
No, right.
We have to accept both. If somebody is able to do it, great, we embrace them.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, we give the same amount of love, affection, and time for anybody who doesn't, who's not able to come, who's able to just connect on Skype. That's fine. There's nothing wrong in it.
Yeah.
I totally believe in it, and it works.
Talking about Guru Shishya Parampara, me and my Guru, we've been teaching thousands of students all over the
world.
Workshops. It's not Guru Shishya Parampara. They just come for us for 5 days, 7 days. And yet, if it is consistently done, if even to give them a spark in the eye, this is where you have to see. It builds up, it shows to them. So both are very important.
Mm-hmm.
What I was I am a little uncomfortable with this generation is too much
information. That's totally
oriented towards
performance.
Not only performance, achieving gains for oneself. Not for the art. They are not deep-rooted and sacrificing and enjoying those beauties of each swara. Yeah, not everyone. But in general, there's in India, quantitatively, it's been 1,000 times better. But qualitatively, the
talented also.
On the other side of the table, I would like to point out that information is very easily available for students. That makes the knowledge very superficial, and the potential is reduced to a great extent. It doesn't sink in whatever is learned. As they go to a concert hall, they just Google and find out the tune and then just play.
And so that process is missing. Undergoing that process of going through the swaras, the emotion, the meaning of the composition, the lyrics, that's missing. So basically it's just on a certain level.
We have fruit vendors who want to sell mangoes. They put it in a room where smoke is available. So it ripens faster, but the taste is missing. Similarly, here the potential, there never used to be a recorder those days. So the students were in full rapt attention. They were able to grasp it in just one repetition. Now you record it, then we can listen to it, take it easy.
Yeah.
So that attitude technology has given.
Fantastic. Yeah.
Just to emphasize the fact of the strong Guru-Shishya relation, I would like to narrate from my Guruji, Pandit Madhavuli, who lived with Pandit Bhimsen Joshi for 28 long years under the true Gurukula system. And he would still feel incomplete about his learning after 28 long years. So look at the mundane education for a while. Like if you go to school for 10 years, 10th grade, PUC 2 years, 12 years, then degree 3 years, 15 years, master's 2 years, 17, another 4 years of PhD, you have a doctor against your name. This boils down to 21 years of formal education and you have a doctorate in front of your name, you become a professor, blah, blah, blah. On the contrary, here is Madhavudi, who has gone to Bhimsen Joshi, learned from him for 28 long years. And he says, oh, Guruji is todi ka gandharam nahi laga sakte.
And he is still, after 28 years, if you meet him, he is exactly same like what he was on the first day. A student, humble. He's come here several times.
I had never seen him sit in front of his Guruji on chair.
He'd just stand or he'll sit on the floor. We all do that.
It's out of respect.
Sheer respect.
Total respect.
Technology in a way has helped to keep it for posterity. That is a big thing. What we lost in the past from our Gurus, because there was no scope for recording. That is very, very vital and very, very much should be taken care of. All what is happening should be preserved very well.
Yeah.
So it's I learned, another point that I would like to place is that I learned music with Appa in a Gurukulam style. I came to Appa when I was hardly 10. And because I come from a small village and there were no ways that I could learn music. So You know, my parents felt that, you know, for learning more music or to learn the right way. I went and stayed, and I stayed there until I finished my post-graduation. I was with my guru. I did the proper Gurukula system. But my parents know me, just like how Didi said. I did not go there because I wanted to sing in movies. Because I wanted to travel, I went there because I wanted to learn, and there was nobody else to teach me. And another thing is that my parents never ever told or never had even an inclination that I should earn or I should do this. There were no agendas.
Right.
Unfortunately now, more than even the students, the parents have a set agenda.
Yeah. Mm.
Thanks, in one way I'm thanking because earlier there was a time when nobody wanted to become a musician because, you know, that was not the way of living.
Yeah.
But thankfully to all the celebrities here and many others, you know, people or the parents saying, okay, you can make a lot of money, you can have a lot of fame. So the agenda before even sending the child to a guru, to a celebrity guru or non-celebrity guru, I have seen, you know, the children go from one teacher to another and finally end up in a celebrity to tag along the celebrity names, oh, I'm so-and-so's thing. So what are the things, you know, pluses that I can have? So it's very agenda-oriented. Mm. I'm not saying all of them, but most of them are.
Yeah.
And that's not a thing because, you know, the joy of learning for nothing they miss.
Right.
You know, you just be in the art for just being, just for
the
sake of being in art and learn because you really do not know that there's so much to learn.
Yeah.
That joy, which takes you all along as a student, I think all these guys miss.
They miss it.
Yeah, because everything is agenda. You know, I go to this person, I have it. So that is...
Short
technology also is sometimes doing a negative, even though it's wonderfully helping the sky people who are, you know, want to do that. But, you know, they all make self-made artists and then self-made gurus.
Right.
Because they have a good access with the technology.
Yeah.
That is not welcome is what even I feel.
Yeah, and that's seen in the rise of, like, several dance classes, music classes. Somebody learns for 3 years and 4 years and they start their own classes as well. So coming to the next point, like, because Indian classical arts is so spiritually steeped and steeped in a mythology, but at the same time, if an artist wants to grow, he has to, you know, look out for performance opportunities to reach to more people. So how does a present day artist like find that balance? I'm sure the journey is endless, the inner journey is endless, but when it comes to presenting the art, so what should a young artist follow? Like, what should he do for the outer?
Not compromise with the art, the style, the material, but open up the mind to look around. If in relation to our dance forms, we already take up several themes which are more contemporary than what was taken before. But only those themes which are can be appropriately taken into art and not something which is not correct. Which doesn't suit the art form. So we should remember about the parameters. One question which you have in mind even within this question is the contemporary feel which the artists are bringing about. Somehow they are going too much overboard. They are losing the beauty of the art form most of the times, and I sometimes get really angry. I said, why are these artists not banned? Who has given them the authority to defame, to deform, to play about with the age-old tradition which so carefully the great masters have nurtured and brought to a... Birju Maharaj ji or Pandit Ravi Shankar ji or any one of them never needed to compromise. When they were on stage, they did what they wanted, what they thought was important, his father and everyone, all the great people. But people came head over heels, houses were full. So because these students nowadays don't have that strength, they do not have that quality, the depth and the repertoire as strong as it should be, that is why they are playing and trying to bring about lighter things which lightly people take and enjoy as if it's just going to any light entertainment.
Right.
But this has to be weighed against
and stick to the roots.
Yeah.
Stick to
yeah.
the
yeah.
not compromise.
You cannot deform it. You cannot deform the forms. That is what is doing, especially with dance. A lot is being just damaged.
Any subject, I think, any subject.
Yeah.
Luckily, Arup bhai, tabla mein kya karega koi?
Hey, tabla to first of all, you know, the guru. You have to learn properly.
Yes.
Like, you know, nowadays, as you were saying, you know, I totally agree with you. They don't have patience. Like within 3-4 years, they want to perform.
Yeah.
And they are looking for the shows, you know, how to make money, how to fame.
Things have become fast-paced.
Very fast-paced.
And
big profiles.
Yeah,
that's
but it's all to do with how quick you can achieve.
Mm.
And everybody today comes with a goal. They have, they basically put it down very clearly within themselves that I'm putting in X amount of time.
Mm.
What is the return?
Mm.
Yeah.
Very clearly, I have spoken to so
like
many
a commercial venture.
Yeah, yeah.
Very, very,
yeah.
very clear. They are in their head. I'm not commenting whether it's good
we
or bad.
We all need money to survive. We all need
yeah.
everything.
But we
that is
said we doesn't matter what happens.
Things
we just
of life.
Do it.
But
how
our
the guru
passion
wants us
towards
to do it.
The
passion
music
was greater.
Is the bottom line
I think
of
that's
yeah.
why unfortunately the depth of the music is going down.
Yeah.
Actually. The Lalgudi Bani, about which I can talk,
yeah.
it has come over years of sadhana, research, and
introspection.
I mean, he has assimilated from different banis and given it an individual style. And every note has a place. Every gamaka, every nuance is carefully passed on. If the nuance is missing, he would stop.
Yeah.
He would say, no, I'm not going to proceed. And then so it is our duty to preserve
Correct.
It and pass it
right,
on.
Exactly.
So it is our responsibility because when you change, see I see many compositions of my guru coming up in a mashup style. They just mix it up with film songs
yeah.
and but for the title they want the mileage and the number of hits. So they name it as Lalgudi Chillana. So this is just using and they don't use give credit, any credit, only for the title they need it and they just don't care about the structure of the composition. They make changes with paying scant respect.
And if these children
very
are
sad.
So intelligent, this generation, why don't they realize that if we lose all this depth of our Indian arts, India is going to really lose the major thing of its identity. These people, they are intelligent, they should think of posterity, they should think of the roots that India, the whole world bows to at the feet of artists, the classical, especially the classical artists, or even the very strong folk-rooted art forms, which India has so beautifully given
India
to
India is known,
the
basically,
world,
world over.
So these people don't realize what damage they are doing. They are making Bhasmasura and then later they will be left with nothing. They will lose their own identity. They will be neither modern, nor traditional, nor Indian, nor Western. They don't realize this. Soon it's going to be a real catastrophe.
And coming to the performance part, what the question is, nowadays it is like you scratch my back, I scratch your back.
Yeah.
We create a festival and call them, invite them, and they create a festival, invite them.
Mm.
But don't do that. You wait for your chance. If you are good, you will get your chance.
People
That's what
you.
I feel.
Correct.
Yeah.
Very, very true.
You wait for your opportunity to go on stage.
Until then you
instead
just...
Instead of searching for the festivals and applying so many where and paying and dancing or paying and performing.
Let's practice.
Yeah.
On the
instead of that, you should wait.
Yeah.
They'll invite you.
Yeah. On the lines of the students taking the art with the respect and the greatness that the art itself, I think it's also the responsibility of the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, there are so many half-baked or not even half-baked, quarter-baked and 0.1-baked cocooning teachers all over the place. They know X number of songs, or they know X number of talims or whatever it is, or X number of 2-3 things. They have seen Shashwati somewhere dancing. So I'm a Kathak dancer and I'm teaching. So what happens is that they don't have anything to give other than just 3 compositions or 3 songs. They will never be able to impart.
But why does the intelligent parents and the intelligent students do not judge where to take your children. Why intelligence can't, where do they lose their sensibility and their intelligence?
Yeah, but you do not know unless I know what the form of
art
is.
Everyone can find out who is a good teacher, who is a, parents, if they want to give their students, the children, the right kind of...
Yeah, but I think with the modern way of life, in the sense that it's become very difficult for
Didi has a very valid point. What she's basically saying, you have to standardize.
Mm.
You have to have a standard. And I think it's a very important thing. The existing masters, the existing vidwans, they should get together and they should select.
Mm.
In every field, who is capable and who is not.
Absolutely. Standardization should be there. Unfortunately, it's not there.
Even
so
our government
it's never
India
been there. She's so right.
Even
totally agree.
In the government, they are not sensitive towards this. They're putting anyone and everyone in so many important organizations, selection committees and so on and so. But just because they have contact, they are so... This is very, very unfortunate.
Maybe we
should
have a proper cultural minister who is much aware of the culture and art.
I think an artist should be a cultural minister, not somebody who is not related.
Well, I think that experience has always backfired.
Okay.
It's never worked.
Okay.
A performing artist to be a cultural minister,
it's
terrible. You'll find them performing all over the world.
Okay. Yeah.
That doesn't work. And they'll be taking their own...
Maharaj ji was
perhaps
made
a cultured person can be a cultural minister.
Yes.
Yeah.
Maharaj ji was made director for 1 year at Kathakendra. He got so stuffed.
Yeah, exactly.
He said, my God, what am I doing?
Yeah.
I rather please quit. Yeah. I want to do my work of teaching and performing. Mm. So
because I think there should be a rule. If you have a performing artist to be a cultural minister, the rule should be they should be able to perform then.
Yes,
exactly.
Right?
For that period.
And that's like catastrophic for a performing musician. You can't ask. So they cannot be leading a dual role.
Yes.
Right.
So as soon as you get power, any opportunity, big opportunity, they say, yeah, I'm there.
Either
don't worry about it.
Or if you can't do, then your relatives and friends.
Friends and the list is endless.
No, Devie, I know of somebody who was appointed as cultural and when they are, they said, no, if I'll perform, I'll perform. The other people are just not even ready. Don't even,
exactly.
They're not good. You know?
So that's
so
totally
kind of closing
out of
doors for so many people. Unfortunately, there
no,
are some
these
things
are
which
light
are not
discussions,
open.
But really, the there is not a very fair means of deciding factors which will preserve our.
I feel Western music, Western dance, it's far more organized.
Yeah,
it's far more. There is a certain standard where, and people are far more honest.
Mm.
I have met so many people who have learned, say violin for 20 years.
Mm.
And I have asked, say in Chicago, I have a student who wants to learn violin, Western violin. Can you? He says, no, you know what? I play, I have learned also, but I don't think I'm a teacher. I'll give you a name of somebody who...
This
aspect
there,
is somehow missing
in our culture.
It should come from within. There shouldn't be any law or anything which is governing. No, it should come
that's
from within. No, I play the sitar, but I am not equipped to be a teacher because I don't have the talim, I don't have the knowledge. I play it for myself. Mm. I've learned it, from maybe Pandit Ravi Shankar.
Everyone is using art for material gains.
Exactly.
That's the biggest problem. No one is using for, the new generation, most of them.
Mm.
Of course, there are several who really, even amongst our young students, they are really so devoted that even coming from rich family, I used to always say rich family children never become good artists because they have too much of luxury at home and they have 10 types of, but I have really proved myself wrong many a times. If they passionately take it, they don't care. They are
passion is
on
what
it.
Is extremely.
Along with being the teachers, even as performers, as you're saying, there is a certain amount of integrity and honesty that you have to exhibit everywhere.
Mm.
I would just like to quote an anecdote. Pandit Bhimsenji was invited to Kerala by a very rich diamond merchant. He would have an annual festival every year. And Panditji was invited, and when he was tuning the Tanpura in the green room, and one gentleman came and said, I would like to request you for a dollar. And Panditji said, I'm tuning my Tanpura, please come onto the stage. Let's do what we can do in the auditorium. So he comes onto the auditorium, again the tabla is being tuned and he says, Panditji, aaj raag jog gai. Please render raag jog today. And Panditji makes an announcement. He is in his mid-50s when this happened. He makes an announcement on microphone. Look, my dear, I have not learned raag jog properly.
Wow.
I don't want to give a haphazard presentation of raag jog. Okay? So, if and when time permits, maybe next year also, I will come prepared and sing raag jog.
Wow.
It doesn't mean that you will invite me next year. I am not putting an application for next year's festival. But if and when the opportunity presents, I will come well prepared and sing that. And that was the end of that day. He sang a beautiful darbari, etc., etc. That will go. But incidentally, he was invited for the same festival next year also. This time, he voluntarily makes an announcement. Last year, one gentleman had asked me to sing raag jog. I have come well prepared for that. I am going to sing that.
Wow.
So this is the kind of integrity.
Wow.
And he learnt it from Ustad Latafat Hussain.
Wow.
Can you believe it?
Agra.
From a different gharana.
Mm.
He went to him, learnt it, mastered it, and presented it.
Because it's a Agra gharana.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, sure.
So this is the kind
it's
of
a speciality
we
of
to
exhibit
everywhere.
Basic, I think, towards your own self and your art, you need to have that sort of integrity and honesty.
And I think what I have always said, from absolute childhood, as soon as the bachcha is starting, there should be some input given to them on our culture, our values, our tradition, which is finished nowadays.
Yeah. That's missing.
Parents
that's
don't
missing.
Have the time,
absolutely.
Teachers have devised different
that's
ways
absolutely.
Of teaching.
Yeah.
And when you grow old, then a spiritual guru comes and preaches you, and you already become a badmash. What is this guru going to convert you into? So, from
very true.
The
mantra should be
what I heard from my mother when I was a little kid of 2-3 years. What she had said, no, don't do this. I remember it even today, and I will never do that thing because it touched me at that time.
Yeah, absolutely.
So these things are now.
Missing.
We are losing
missing, yeah.
Nuclear families, parents working, children are not under proper care.
Yeah,
mostly.
Everybody knows
but
everything.
Luckily,
but it's
some
so
of the
true,
houses.
So true. This, you know, the mantra should be catch them young.
Yeah.
Catch them.
And
catch
they
them.
Keep
catch
it for all their life.
Yeah, absolutely.
They will not forget.
Yes.
I mean,
they will
know. That's the age, you know.
That's the age. You
the
give
age.
Them, you sow the
yeah.
seed,
yeah.
and it will
yeah.
be a huge tree one day.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know, it's very true.
Yeah, you can play soft music for a kid, for
yeah.
a child,
yes.
newborn kid,
yes.
and it sinks
even
into
before.
This yeah. subconscious.
When the child
even
is conceived.
The consciousness.
They don't put anything
yeah.
Indian. That's
absolutely.
The only problem now.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
We have the serial mania now, so everything revolves around that. So all violence
and
wrong things get injected into the
and
child
when you
are young.
Of contemporary
correct.
And modern and fusion, think of his father and his guru and all. Staying within tradition, what they have
done
yeah. the world will bite their fingers out. So, I mean, what are these children thinking? What are they heading towards? Nothing actually.
Country, eh?
Neither creation. They are. When it comes to dance, I say become one some Uday Shankarji,
right.
then talk about fusion. He has
yeah.
created a whole style in his lifetime. So
from nowhere.
From nowhere.
No
from
background
no
of
background.
Dance.
No background. So
yeah.
what is all these children
so
talking
true.
About fusion?
Yeah.
And again, coming back to the standardization within classical arts, do you think it's a challenge for Indian classical arts because it is a solo format, whereas in Western classical, whether you take ballet or the orchestra, it's more of a group enterprise. So it's easier to get people, you know, together and have a director. Whereas in classical arts, once a person says, yes, I am a dancer, the creative decisions are with individuals. So do you think like that is coming in the way of like having a standard?
I think it's to do
or?
With the system.
No,
that,
yeah.
Here there is a process of audition,
yeah.
there is a process of screening, which is strictly followed. It's not that I know Shashwati Di says, I'm sending my daughter. Shashwati Di, please, can you take her in your next production?
And truly speaking,
so,
not every artist is happy with creation and fusion. So why should the audience sometimes doesn't expect everyone to be
correct.
I personally I do not like all these contemporary ideas coming into creation. So I will not do it if I don't like it, but that doesn't make me a smaller artist,
definitely,
a lesser artist.
Yeah.
But that element of compromise should not be there.
Yeah.
You select, even if your own son or daughter is not capable, you should be able to put your foot down and say, no, I'm not
in
going to take
field,
you in my next
because
direction.
I'm sitting in London and I'm saying someone's name which most of the dance world knows, Kumudini Lakia ji, one of the greatest choreographers in the field of Kathak and in dance. She, and everyone is following pursuit, everyone in Kathak field, when they're choreographing, maximum inspiration and, but she was a born thinker in this form. She and Maharaji worked together in their young age.
Yeah.
He would give the classical input and she would inspire all the choreographic moves.
She was a great communicator.
Yeah. So nowadays people are taking from here, from there, from everywhere and putting their stamp saying that, yes, I strongly say that these people should be warned not to do this.
Yeah.
And the audiences should be a little more understanding, discerning.
Educated, I
to
think.
Understand
receptive
between the good
educated.
And the bad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's, I think,
Red,
the job of the artist. It's
a
duty
artist.
Of the artist.
As a solo, yeah, of course, see, solo comes the next part because we all are coming from the tradition of a group where it's from a dance drama format.
Yes.
Then it came to
then
follow.
It
became a
solo.
When it comes to dance dramas, I don't see any boundaries we should stick to, like, and also, Devi said, we have to stick to our roots before we start creating something on our own. We are nobody to create
the
on our own. It's already done.
Be
it is written in Natyashastra thousands of years ago. We are just following some of the glimpses from that.
Right.
That's what I feel. That's my
It's all there. You just rediscover and
understand.
Just bring it back to life.
These students are just reading Natyashastra and they think they have understood the arts. It's not only reading, they have to go in. Okay.
Nobody has created anything. We are just following what are the footsteps followed by our gurus and the scriptures and epics, what we have, Ramayana, Mahabharata.
And when,
tremendous.
And when they say, talk about Krishna Radha stories are age old. Some of the critics also sometimes refer, Krishna, what is age old? Even today there is a Krishna who is playfully playing with the mother or teasing the another girl. But saying that George is teasing Wendy is not as graceful as Krishna is teasing Radha, because they have a divine image. They are a symbol of love and happiness and joy. All these icons, these mythological icons, are not character, they are not people. They are symbols of Rama,
and it's
a
very
symbol
cultural
of virtuousness.
Well.
So it is these dances and these characters are never obsolete and never old.
Yeah.
Even today there is a Ravana, even today there is a Rama and a Krishna and a Yashoda.
It is just a perspective you have to look into.
Yes.
I think human emotions are universal and they are timeless. So you can't say one emotion is old, one emotion is new, that doesn't.
Yeah.
The characters change.
Yes.
Characters change, the emotions remain the same. Yeah.
But many times people say, oh, Krishna stories and they are so old.
It's timeless.
Timeless,
Coming to the Natya Shastra, I'm sure, as you said, we are not actually following the 100% of it, but it does have, you know, specifications mentioned for like how a dancer should be and things like that. Whereas in today's world, it's not just the Indians who are practicing the art form. A lot of Westerners are taking it up. So should the rules apply there? Like, what is your perception on that? Should we again follow
why
the Natya Shastra?
Even if there's a Westerner, we have so many foreign students who come and we teach them
they study,
Margam and we teach them the exact Padhati, the way it should be learned.
I totally agree because we follow Kurtz Act when the Russian choreography, the ballet choreographers were there. There is a book written by Kurtz, Kurtz Act, there are five elements which you follow in the stage for the choreography. Exactly, they need to follow the Natya Shastra. Why not? Because each division of the stage is written there, how to do a lighting, how to do how to make an entry,
right.
How to exit the stage. You're not supposed to show dying on stage. There are so many rules written. They should follow Natyashastra.
Yeah.
Right. And should we be very, what do you say, specific in terms of what Natyashastra says? Like it says, you know, just as an example, as a small example, you know, the dancer should have big eyes or the dancer should have a round face. Whereas a lot of people are not exactly like that. So
no,
how do we...
That, those
I
things are, I mean, those are... What one says conventionally, these are something, but whatever God has made us,
we
go by that.
Yeah.
So that is the typical, most appropriate, the perfect Padmini Naika is the perfect
the basic,
name. But
basic element is the Rasotpatti.
Yes.
Once the audience has taken all the rasa, what you are doing on stage, like if you are crying, they should cry. When the Rasotpatti is there, then you are,
you have attained that.
You are correct in your things.
Correct.
Yeah. And since all of you are so well traveled and you've seen how Indian art is perceived in different parts of the world, do you find there is any difference in the way it is or how it is practiced in different countries or what's your ideas on that?
You mean the artists in...
Like for example, you're here for the summer school. So the students here, they're born and brought up in London. They're not like, as an Indian child would be, they're not brought up in that kind of a context. So does that make any difference? Or?
Absolutely, it makes a lot of difference.
Yes.
And I should, I usually advise my students to visit India and be in the know of things and the current situation and to feel the air and hear the music and visit the temples, because that makes a huge difference.
Yeah.
And it influences the personality, the creativity, and the way you express your art. Because without your knowing, there is a seasoning happening within you. When you are in that ambience and surrounding, just as a student would benefit immensely if you were to be in the Gurukula system. So listening to these concerts in Chennai makes a huge difference, and you will know the state of art only when you know how much ever you listen, you watch YouTube, the feel is different.
The tangible feel is
watching,
different.
Watching live is completely different than watching
right.
in TV or a visual art.
Definitely.
In that way, do you know, when I started teaching here, my very initial days, years experience, two, three things which I taught myself, I learned. I had young students, the intermediate one, that at that time, Bhavan had lots of students, so those little ones came. Once I was in class, I taught them. After that, we usually talk and share. What did you understand? What did you like? And one bacha comes and said, I said, how were you happy today? No, it was so boring. I said, oh, yeah, yes, it was boring. So what could I say? I said, yes. Didn't you feel it was boring to those? Yes. I said, yes, you know why? Can you tell me why? You know, you repeated all those things which we had learned before. I said, yes, exactly. I felt the same way. So it taught me that these children have learned it and their expectation is further. Once I was doing some teaching them Mukha Bhav, without words. So I said, okay, just for your general, tell me what I'm expressing. So I, flowers picking and all that. Then I said, okay. What did I do? So one girl picked her. You are feeling pukey, you want to throw up. So I said, oh, yes. Okay, I was like, said, yeah. Because you're doing pukey, you want to throw up. Yes. Oh, yes. And how would you say when you're thirsty and want to drink water, can you express in your mouth? I said, yes, exactly. So there was the cultural difference which has to be explained to them. Draupadi, I was teaching once, I said, in your mind, what are you saying when she's lifting her hands to Krishna? Please help me, Lord. I said, oh, please don't say it that way. Say it in the way that the words have been written. Draupadi ki laaj rakho. Please say it in the Indian way. Feeling that Indian way and not please,
yeah.
Please, that please will
yeah.
immediately bring about.
Right.
So there are so many things
so
which
many
we
things.
Should
yes.
joyfully
yeah.
understand, but we explain and
I think that's the reason why we are here, because I'm not sure how many of them are able to go to India and experience
yeah.
this.
Mm.
But if we come here for, say, 3 weeks, at least we are able to give them a glimpse of what it meant to us
mm.
and what it means to us, and give them, and I think that's the whole idea about the summer school,
yeah.
that we
mm.
bring our
and
art
so
exactly
nice.
In a way how we have taken
and especially
it. And give them a taste
that,
of it.
So that
and if we can inspire maybe even one student
mm.
to do what Krishnan just said, that come to India,
yeah.
come to the temples, come to a concert, watch the Guru Shishya Parampara, maybe be part of it, I think we have done our,
yeah.
our
yeah.
service
even
to
even one student if we can inspire.
But
yeah.
I think in back in India, the metros are even worse than the other,
okay.
you know, the Western influence and how
mm.
they want to do only what is done.
Right.
West, I mean, for them, West is just America, not even
UK.
UK.
Yeah.
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 So whatever is done in America is what they want to do. So they take everything for granted. So
mm.
the art forms or whatever, they're just not bothered about that. For that way, I think outside India, the
passion,
you know, passion
is,
and how they
whoever
treat
comes,
it,
they
the
know the value of time
yeah. Yeah.
and
yeah.
they're wasting energy and money. So they meaningfully learn.
And it's
yeah.
mostly the parents who realize that they have left India. And I feel it's
yes.
predominant in the southern
mm.
Indian communities, that they are very careful that when their son or daughter, they are born in London or in Chicago
yeah,
or in
yeah.
Los Angeles,
mm.
they want to make sure that every weekend they take them
yeah.
to language class, to dance
their
class,
roots.
So that they
yeah.
are connected to the roots.
Yeah.
They make it a point to go in the kachari
yeah.
season.
Yes.
No, not only Indians, Sri Lankans, South Indians.
And
Sri
yeah,
Lankans.
Connected. That's why it's a southern part
yeah.
of,
yeah.
even in Singapore also, Malaysia. You will find them far more
devoted.
They work
devoted
hard
rooted
in
to stay connected.
Yeah.
It's still
yeah.
missing largely in the
in
North
the
Indian communities,
yeah.
Punjabis or
no, all over
from
the
Delhi
metros,
or
all over here.
I don't say metro. Chennai
I
is a
know
metro.
About Malaysia
yeah,
also.
Yeah.
I know
people
about
from
here.
Chennai. I
they are not professionals.
So
they are doing a different profession.
They
are doctors. They are engineers.
It.
They are working in banks, but they are learning this.
Might be.
Surely.
But still, when you compare to a person coming from, say, Punjab or Delhi,
yeah, you're
to
right.
a person from Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra
yeah.
or Bengal, I will even take out Bengal. Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, they are far more connected to
rooted.
The tradition and to the roots.
Yes.
And the parents devote a lot more of their
they
time,
drive hours,
miles.
They
and
wait
miles.
Outside, they read a book or go to a coffee shop.
Yeah.
They're waiting while their kids
and
are getting there.
Aradhana, the
yeah, you have
yeah.
Cleveland.
Everyone
the Veda classes. Veda classes.
Knows
Sanskrit
it
classes.
By heart.
Yeah.
Yeah. They know
so
it by heart.
I have sung in Purandara Festival in Chicago 5 times.
Yeah,
5 times.
So it is brilliant.
I think it's that fear of losing their culture which
yeah.
like makes
yeah.
them hold
yeah.
on to
yeah,
it much
yeah.
more.
Absolutely.
I guess.
Yeah.
In fact, in Boston, they had organized one event for Vachanas of 12th century,
mm.
exclusively the 12th century components of Karnataka, medieval Karnataka. They invited many artists from
yeah.
Cleveland,
yeah.
Tyagaraja Aradhana.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
And the vice versa is my colleague in Elmhurst College, Chicago. Professor Mark Harbord, he has attended Tiruvayar Tyagaraja Aradhana 8 times. I have not gone there once even today.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
He makes it a point all the way from Chicago. He comes there, sits there with a dhoti around, enjoys the whole season and comes
mm-hmm.
There's a lot of positive
yeah.
give and take between the
yeah.
West and the Indian.
Because they miss it.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
miss it,
yes.
yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
And because they care.
They
care about it. It makes a difference to their life and they realize it.
Yeah.
I mean,
it makes them very secure.
Yes.
Somewhere it is like taken for granted.
Mm.
Yeah.
Back
home.
Things taken
things
for granted
for
is.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought up the vachanas.
Yeah.
I think one of the most beautiful things about Indian arts is like all the art forms are so interconnected.
Yeah.
Dance is inspired by sculptures,
mm.
cannot exist without music. Music again, if you take the paintings, the Ragamala paintings
yes.
inspired by musical notes.
So I'd love to hear your experiences, and especially for the, I mean, for dance, it's already known. Without music, there is no dance. But I'd love to hear what the musicians feel about it, like what inspires you apart from your own art.
Yeah, I can tell about my Guruji, who came up with a novel idea of presenting his own compositions, Eight Tilanas, in way back in 1979. And he presented it with orchestras. Nowadays, we see many compositions presented with the orchestra, but he was the pioneer then. And when the HMV people came and asked him, what can be the title? He immediately came up with this title, The Dance of Sound. So,
nice.
So we have to, Gaurav already mentioned it, a musician becomes a classy one when he is able to see the notes. The notes can see them dance. You don't have to go and watch a dance performance for getting inspired. The notes themselves, you can see them dance. So that is
very true.
Inspiration.
You know, it reminds me of a very beautiful experience. 11th December 2012, my guru left this world. Just a month before, I went and I spent about 3 weeks with him in his house in San Diego. Lived with. He was very frail, but even in that problems with his heart and everything, he was practicing twice a day, morning 1 hour, evening religiously every day. So once I remember in the afternoon, he called me. He says, "I will play. I just want you to sit and listen." So he was playing, and he played for almost 40 minutes. After that, I just saw some, you know, water on his eye. I thought maybe he's sweating, but he was so deep into it, I feared to go and wipe his sweat. But in a few minutes, I saw that he's sobbing, and he was crying. So I got a little worried. And he was frail. He was really not in a very... And he stopped, and all of a sudden he had huge eyes, and he looked at me, and it was dark in the room, and it was piercing absolutely. And he knew that it was time for him to move on. And he looked at me and he says, "You know, I have struggled all my life to converse with a raga, to find the raga correctly, how it should be. Because every raga is like a person. It's like I talk to you, we are talking with each other. And now, finally, I have started seeing the ragas. I'm able to see them in front of me, and it's time for me to go." You know, so you have that relation. You must have that relation, that relationship of love, of hate, of sadness, of... You have to, and that is also a sadhana. That is also a sacrifice. You're trying to relate to somebody, and you're not able to. You're not getting the Gandhar of the Yaman, you're not getting the Tivrama, because it has to be a certain way. Otherwise, it's not Yaman, it's maybe some other rag. So you have to have a visual relationship with your music for it to have a life, because only when it is visual, it will move, and everything what moves is life.
Wonderful.
You know? So I just remembered.
That's a wonderful anecdote.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you all so much for being here
Thanks.
With us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you.
It was so nice because we could hear each other also.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which is very rare.
Which is rare.
We hardly meet each other. Everybody is so busy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think it was wonderful.
Thank you.